Well, it's the first Friday of the month. It's June Woman Today, 50th birthday month, which means that it's time once again for Marina Petropulos, our very own, well, perhaps our adopted baby and childcare specialist, to join us to talk to you about your child. But before we take your call, seeing as we're doing the nostalgic thing this month, we thought it would be really interesting to find out if or how things have changed for mothers and babies over the last 50 years. Are you, for instance, going to be asking the same questions that your mother or even your grandmother might have asked? Well, I wonder. Well, although she's been in the baby business for a good long while, I don't think that Marina can really speak from absolute hands-on experience of 50 years ago. She was not giving out baby care advice then. But certainly in the last 20 or so, she's been at the cutting edge of the latest research and developments. So we're going to be tapping into her personal archive to find out how things have progressed. But more importantly, as I say, she's also here to take your calls, so why not give us a ring? Woman Today, it is on SAFM. It's our baby and childcare phone-in with Marina Petropulos. Here we are in Cape Town. Well, hi, Marina.
Good morning.
Welcome to our birthday show.
Thank you.
And I know for sure you haven't been around for 50 years giving out baby care advice, but I think that your book must be coming up for its 22nd year.
That's right.
Thereabouts, which is fairly awesome. I know that that means that you have helped a huge amount of mothers and babies. In fact, a lot of those babies are grown up now. And I know that you've helped a lot of people, because I remember once being in the studio here, Jeremy Cronin had just walked in and he said, "Oh my word, you helped bring up my children." It must happen to you a lot. People say that their children have been marinated, as it were.
It does happen a lot, and I'm always a little nervous that they'll blame me when things go wrong. But people are always wonderful. I must say I'm terribly grateful for the responses that I get. It makes it all worthwhile.
The response and the responsibility from what you're saying. Is that why you... Because I know that you're very diligent about making sure that your information is absolutely up to date.
Yes.
Are you conscious of that responsibility?
Absolutely. I'm paranoid about it. I am absolutely overwhelmed by it, and I'm constantly thinking, oh, I must put this in, and oh goodness, that has changed, and I must change it. And even though it is cumbersome and expensive to keep making changes to a book, I have to do it. That's why every edition is a little bit different, because things change. And
it would be interesting to measure those differences, but maybe we can talk about them.
Because
over sort of 25, whatever, however many years, very different attitudes just towards having a baby. I mean, I'm not quite sure 20 years ago exactly what people were thinking, but I mean, 50 years ago,
yes,
very different.
That's
right. A lot more mothers would have been stay-at-home mothers, I wonder?
Yes, certainly. There's no question about that. Mothers were stay-at-home mothers, largely. From the late 50s, 60s, women did start going out to work more, but the norm was that a mother stayed at home, look after a baby. And in those days, in any case, the mother's partner, husband, could probably earn enough to look after them. And today, many mothers work of necessity, and many others because it's their choice. Certainly, mothers went into hospital and had a baby and stayed there for up to 5 or even 7 days afterwards when they were recovering from the birth. And in some ways, that was a great luxury, because today it's just too expensive. So you're just pushed in and pushed out, which I think is quite hard, because I think one does need some cosseting and adjusting. But then there were other things. For instance, the babies were put in a communal nursery and the mother didn't get to know the child. So even though she'd been resting, she didn't know her baby when she went home. And then also very often mothers who could afford it would have a nurse that looked after the baby in the first few weeks, if not the first few months, and helped them. So there wasn't that very close interaction that we have today.
I think one has to make a distinction in this country where we've had the maids and madams situation. I suppose a lot of white women perhaps had help, you know, to look after their babies. Would that, has that impacted on what you've...
Well, quite honestly, I think it was a wonderful cultural thing. And again, the greatest luxury on earth, to have another pair of willing hands and very often greatly loving hands. And I think many South Africans of that era who grew up at that time had wonderful relationships with their nannies. And now it doesn't happen quite as often, because children are very often sent to a creche from a very young age.
The sad thing was that the nannies themselves, maybe their own children had to suffer as a result of the nannies bringing
Yes, absolutely.
Bringing
up and I think there is some equity there in that black mothers are now looking after their babies themselves. But I do believe that quite often there was a kind of situation in which if Nanny had a baby herself, she could bring her own baby as well. But that was not the norm. And yes, it's true. The whole thing is one of balance. And I think the balance then was very much skewed against the people who were in employment.
Well, as we're talking about balance, you know, I'm not quite sure when Dr. Benjamin Spock wrote his book. I'm sure you would know.
1936.
But it's 1936, was it that long ago? It's interesting.
46. Sorry, it was a bit later, yes.
So 46.
I think he graduated in 36.
That a man should have been writing a baby care book, or not?
Well, I think in those days it was very much a case of paediatricians. And if you look back at some of the paediatricians that preceded him, Emmett Holt, a professor, for example, said, never kiss your baby, and all sorts of other dreadful, dreadful things. And so, yes, it was a man who wrote the book, but his approach was so different. It was so revolutionary to what came before him that it might as well have been a woman in a sense. The sad thing about Benjamin Spock was that he himself never overcame his upbringing, which was really very, very strict and punitive, and he was not able to put into practice what he preached. So even though he said very many good things about interacting with children, he wasn't able to do it himself. And he was in therapy until his 90s.
Goodness.
Yes. Goodness. Twice a week.
Is that why they refer to Benjamin Spock's children as being Spockmarked?
I haven't heard that one.
But you say that it was suggested that you should never kiss your baby because it was going to spoil them or all those sort of things.
Really?
I think also looking through some of your notes, there was the idea that you should start feeding babies solids from the age of 3 months. In fact, three weeks.
Yes, there was a paediatrician in Johannesburg who said, well, mashed sardines are ideal. And in some ways they do have a lot of goodness in them, but really not. I think the key there was the question of allergies. And ironically, despite the fact that we're all absolutely paranoid about allergies, allergies continue to increase in all population groups all over the world. Mm. So even though the big thing about not feeding solids too early is based on allergies, we've got more allergies. So it's complex. It's never as simple as it might seem.
Also interesting to see that it was quite chic to be smoking, and yes. Smoking was, you know, even through pregnancy, there didn't seem to be a problem
with
that.
There was no problem with any of that.
Whilst we're on the subject of smoking, then, in what way does smoking damage a baby?
Very, very seriously, because smoking deprives the baby of oxygen, and that means that the baby doesn't get to grow and the brain cells. So the average baby that is born to a mother who smoked is many, many grams lighter than the child would have been. So that gives it a handicap. But more importantly, if you were to do tests on a mother when she was smoking, you would find that the baby becomes distressed. It, in effect, gasps for air. So if you could only see that, I'm sure mothers would stop smoking.
Long-term effects?
Long-term effects, learning difficulties, a higher incidence of cot death, general lags developmentally. It really is an absolute no-no of all things. And then, of course, we know about fetal alcohol syndrome.
Do we not ever indeed know about fetal alcohol syndrome? Well, if that isn't enough to make you stub out your cigarette, I'm not sure if you're pregnant. We were talking allergies earlier. We have Denise Milan on the line from Rustenburg. Hi, Denise.
Hi.
Hello, Denise. Tell us your problem.
My baby is nearly 8 months old, and I've been battling with her with formula and milk from the start.
Yes.
She's been about on six types of formula, but she's very constipated.
Yes.
And, well, now my pediatrician has taken her off milk completely and see if that won't make a difference. It looks like if she's allergic, but to the soya it was even worse.
Yes, that's possible.
So I'm not sure now what to give her instead of the milk. She can't take herbal. She used to get a lot of stomach cramps.
Mm.
So I'm giving her diluted fruit juice, and I just want to ask you, can I give her chamomile tea?
You can give her chamomile tea, but what we really need to deal with, Denise, is it sounds to me as though you're substituting these other products like the rooibos and the fruit juice for milk.
That's right.
And you can't do that. because milk is there for the protein and all the other nourishment that it has, and these other things don't have it at all. So if you're going to not be giving milk, and I'm not sure that, you know, that it's not possible to give some form of milk. Soya does cause allergies, and there are many other cow's milk products, but have you gone on to a really well-modified hyperallergenic milk?
She's been on an HA.
And it didn't work for her?
Well, the constipation got so bad that she used to get due for like about 15 mils a day that the pediatrician prescribed, and it didn't help anymore.
Yes. Well, I think you have to get some very good advice on this, because I'm not at all happy with you giving up milk in some form for an eight-month-old baby.
Okay.
She doesn't need that much milk. She needs between 400 and 500 mils. If she isn't going to be having milk in some form, you really mustn't think of fruit juice as being a substitute for it. It's only liquid. And yes, she does need liquid, and that is possibly why she's so constipated. And you may want to give prune juice or something like that if you're giving a fruit juice.
I've been using prunes. I made it myself, everything, but it just didn't help her. It still didn't solve her problem. She was still constipated on that.
Okay. I just have to go back to that product that you were using. It really isn't a habit-forming product, and if you need to do that, you must continue with it rather than, you know, just stop altogether and let her get very, very constipated. But we could talk the whole program about this issue, so I'm going to just try and give you some very strong hints now. She needs to have fruit and vegetables in her diet, as well as protein from meat or chicken, and that should help with, you know, help stuff in her stool. She must have enough fluid. She can have plain boiled water. She doesn't actually have to have, if the robust tea is not good for her, but chamomile tea is fine.
Mm-hmm.
You can give her that. So she must have enough fluids during the day, especially because you live in a hot area. And you need to substitute that protein and calcium that she's not getting from the milk from another source. And there really are many, many alternatives if you were to go into... But, you know, it sounds to me as though your big problem is not that the milk is making her ill, but that it's making her constipated.
That's right.
So I don't think you must be taking her off milk. Perhaps you must go back to one of those other milk products, and I don't want to go into mentioning too many products here, but there is one that has got a slightly soured effect, if I can put it that way, that might be better, but you must talk to your doctor about it, because I don't want to start mentioning too many product names now.
Okay.
And then you must really just continue to give her something for her stools. You mustn't worry too much. It is going to be like addictive or habit forming.
Any sort of supplementation, calcium supplementation?
Well, this is the thing. If she isn't having any form of milk, then you may need to give her a calcium supplement.
Yeah, well, the pediatrician said the same. So he's only going to keep her off milk for 42 hours and then see how she's doing and then give me the supplement.
Oh, I see. So this is just a temporary thing. Okay, fine. But you are hearing me. I don't want to go through it all again, but you do get the idea.
And there isn't that maybe a pediatrician in Gauteng that you know that may be able to help me that's more specialized in allergies and constipation?
Well, maybe you should contact the Johannesburg General Hospital and ask them for the allergy clinic there and speak to them.
Okay, I'll do that.
Try that. Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Good luck, Denise.
Okay, thanks. Bye-bye.
Marina, the very fact that there are babies around these days, that has changed so much. I'm just thinking that one of the other things that you told me was that it was 1978 when Louise Brown was the first test tube baby. 1978,
yes.
That's what... It's a long time ago, anyway.
More than 30 years,
something
yes.
like that. And, you know, but test tube babies are happening all the time now in vitro fertilization.
Yes, that's been a most remarkable change in that there are so many different ways today of helping infertile couples. It's quite phenomenal.
And adoption, you know, all those sort of things, artificial insemination, the stigma still there?
Well, you know, I saw an advertisement in the paper the other day asking for eggs. Because obviously the mother wasn't producing eggs and they wanted to have a baby. Now, isn't that a remarkable thing? Mm. One wouldn't have believed that possible 50 years ago.
Well, as you say, definitely the subject for a whole program on its own. We have talked about it before, but one that's ceaselessly fascinating. Let's hear from Kathy in Johannesburg. Hi, Kathy.
Hi, good morning. My problem is this. My gardener asked me if I would employ his wife, in inverted commas, who is the mother of a two-year-old. And the little puddle when he's playing outside with his dad in the garden is actually not too bad. But he does seem to use the Scots expression, girn an awful lot. And I don't know whether it's because he's endlessly being told, no, don't do that.
Yes.
My husband has even got to the stage where he says dryly when he comes home in the evening, he says, aha, he says, has the destroyer been here today?
Yes.
And whatever the child touches literally disintegrates into many small pieces. And I love it when he goes to sleep in the morning, when he's tired and when he doesn't
what are you saying?
Well, what I'm asking is it because he's endlessly being told, no, don't? Or is it because there's something the matter that he's always girning?
Yeah.
Or what is it?
Is it not because he's just 2 years old?
I think that it's not unusual for a two-year-old. I think that your child is possibly terrified that he's going to do the wrong thing, and so he is overcorrected, as you said. He's constantly being told no. A two-year-old to be placed into a fragile environment, so to speak, is really quite unfair. If this little one could be left in some kind of a situation where he could be playing like a normal two-year-old.
That's the point. I've asked. I really pointedly said, can't you? And she said, her sister is in Natal and there's nowhere else to leave it.
But there are places, it's usually about 150 rand a month or 200 rand a month where children can go and be looked after.
Oh, I see what you mean.
I think it's probably a financial thing, and I think it's really unfair on him and unfair on you too, because nobody's comfortable with it.
Yeah.
So
okay,
talk to her about it and see if somebody can sponsor this child in an environment where he'll be happier.
Well, sponsoring would have to be me, because I'm the sole employer.
Okay. Good luck, Kathy. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Marina, we talked about the paediatrician who recommended giving babies mashed sardines at the age of 3 weeks, and I went into shock. But why should I go into shock? I mean, you know, in primitive times, were children not eating solid foods at that sort of age? I don't know.
It's quite interesting, and it's also a long story, because I once did a study on it. There were variations of gruel, in effect, and bread dipped in milk, and they were very often given a piece of very undercooked meat to suck, which actually is not a bad thing. It had the right components, but it wasn't quite as balanced as we would like it to be today. And the sad thing is that in many countries, traditional feeding is still done for babies, and only traditional feeding that is really brilliant for babies is breastfeeding. For the rest of it, unfortunately, it does not provide for babies' needs, especially after 6 months. Very often, there isn't enough protein given, and then you get that protein energy malnutrition of kwashiorkor. And to me, that is really something we should be concentrating on, but it's very, very difficult to change cultural practices. It can be done, but it's difficult because there's usually a financial aspect to it as well.
Breastfeeding, we know now that breast is best,
yes,
if it's possible, and with HIV/AIDS being an issue at the time, it's not always possible.
Yes.
So if one is not able to breastfeed, and it happens for all sorts of reasons, bottle feeding, what other supplements should one be getting, or with all the, you know...
Well, formula milk today is very sophisticated, and they're trying
sophisticated?
It's certainly sufficient for the first 4 to 6 months. You might have to change the formula to go onto a slightly, inverted commas, richer formula, more casein-based formula. But it is absolutely fine. It will certainly help the child grow. It's just those very subtle, wonderful things like the antibodies, which are live substances in breast milk, that you won't have. And, of course, now the long-chain fatty acids and things like that are becoming terribly important, and they're great for brain development, and we're finding that you get it in breast milk and it's lacking in other milks.
Brain development thing is an interesting one you mentioned.
Yeah,
I think you mentioned
the critical one.
Yeah, and, you know, I think there also some while back, actually bottle feeding was recommended.
Oh, yes.
And one wonders, you know, all those people who have grown up now, if they're all suffering from sort of underdeveloped brains because they were bottle fed.
There's an article in this week's Time magazine written by, I don't know, a professor of neurology or something, or something like that. It says basically that the longer you are breastfed, the smarter you're likely to be. Now, that obviously is a study that was done with a comparison of very first world babies, because, and sadly, we can't say that all babies who are breastfed for the first 2 or 3 years are smarter than any other babies. But he does end up, the very clever man who wrote it, saying, well, I was only breastfed for 2 weeks or something, I don't remember exactly, but the inference is clear, well, he was pretty bright anyway. So it's multifactorial.
Well, we will never ever
find
out
for
what
one
it
moment
is that
say,
makes a person.
You know, if only it were that easy.
Indeed, indeed. Nature, nurture, all those things.
Yeah.
Laverne from Cape Town has a bit of an issue. Hi, Laverne.
Hi. It's one of those things that people don't like talking about. Worms.
Oh, yes.
And one of those things
goes with the territory,
them.
Though.
Oh, well, that's it. I mean, I've never dewormed my son. He's 18 months old and eats like a horse. But he takes after his father, who used to be a jockey and is slightly built. But I don't know if one should just worm him as a sort of...
It's a change to get a complaint about a child who eats too much
or too well,
as opposed to one who doesn't. Laverne, it does not necessarily apply, strangely enough. Children with worms very often have a very poor appetite because they become anemic. But worms, again, is a big subject. There are various types, and some of them, yes, the child might eat well. There is no harm at 18 months, especially in a country such as South Africa, to deworm. And I would just do it.
Okay.
It's very easy.
That's another
absolutely
risk factor, isn't
it? Do you know, in some areas, because you can even breathe in those little eggs, and children are highly susceptible, and they're always picking their nose and playing in the sand and doing all sorts of nasties, that the prevalence is 97%. So I would say...
So it's okay to give them that.
It's not harmful if they don't have worms. So you should feel okay about that.
Thanks very much.
And it's quite palatable too.
Oh, great. You'll eat that with relish, like everything else.
Just before you go, Laverne, I mean, he's 18 months now, Marina. What sort of age... Does one just... Is it a one-off? Or how many times do you do it?
It depends on what you're looking for. It can be a one-off. You must... The labelling is very clear. Or you might need to repeat it. But either way, it's actually a liquid, tastes like
But at 18
vanilla.
Months, I mean, he's probably
it's a fine
fairly
age.
Sturdy little
It's a good age to do it. It's not too young, what you're saying. You don't want to do it to a six-month-old baby. But yes, that's fine.
Okay.
Thanks
and
very much.
It's... One should really just do it.
Go for it, Laverne.
you may get a shock as to what appears.
Okay.
Thanks for joining us. Well, maybe we'll go into that. It's a little bit near lunchtime, but nonetheless, let's, before we do, hear from Mike. Hi, Mike.
Good morning, ladies.
Hi.
Hi.
I have a baby, his name is 3.5 months old at this moment.
Yes.
We had him weighed about 3 weeks back. He was 4.5 kilos. He was born 2.6 at birth.
Right. He says doubled. Well, yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Now, the thing is that we first had him on a soy milk supplement.
Yes.
Which we then changed, because he's a very hungry little fellow, we changed to one of the products with an S. Okay, and he's now got to a point where 225 ml a time is not enough for him. So in between, we started feeding him with a bit of rice cereal and a bit of squash.
Okay.
At 3.5 months, do you think this is advisable or not?
Well, if he's doing well on it, it's really fine. And it's satisfying him, and the rice cereal in particular really won't be a problem. So continue with that, and slowly you can start introducing. He's a little bit small in weight terms. He's only 4.5 kilos. I would prefer him to be 6 kilos. So rather than too rapidly be introducing something else, stick with the rice cereal. Squash is okay, but it really doesn't have that much nutrient value. So I wouldn't bother too much with that.
He was 4.5 kilos, but about 3 weeks back we had him measured. He's going again next week for his weight and for his third set of injections. But I think he's run about 6 kilos at the moment.
Oh, fine. Okay, then he's definitely in the arena. So I would carry on with the cereal. And in due course, in another 2 weeks or so, start introducing vegetables. You can do squash. I don't know if you're cooking it yourself.
What would be a good substitute for squash?
Some of the fruits, perhaps, and other vegetables. Squash has got the least, unless it's butternut. butternut would be different, but those little gem squash are really just water.
I do remember seeing in your book that it says that they are just virtually,
you know,
water.
It's fine and they're nice and all of that, but you don't want to waste stomach space with stuff that really doesn't have
so a
very
little
high...
a little bit of butternut.
Yeah, that would be fine. Excellent.
Does that help, Mike?
Darcy, thanks a lot.
You're on track. It's fine.
Have a nice day.
Okay.
Good
Thank
luck.
Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Bye.
Marina Petropulos, babies and appetites and food, and we were listening to Laverne talking earlier about her little chap who's obviously eating up a storm, and then we heard about the other little three-month-old, and you recommended that squash wasn't maybe a good thing. And I keep thinking spinach, you know, we've all seen Popeye and all that story, but spinach, it's a bit of an overrated product, I believe.
Well, spinach is fine because green leafy vegetables are great for anyone. However, spinach is normally given because of the iron content, and the iron content is not nearly as great as we thought, and it's also not nearly as well absorbed. Iron from any vegetable or plant source is not as easily absorbed as it is from an animal source. There are substances in plants that actually counter the absorption of the iron. The other thing about giving spinach to very young babies is that if you were to cook spinach today and keep it in the fridge and give it tomorrow, that spinach again has been altered and it can make for a very runny tummy. So it's not recommended that you give very young babies spinach.
What about broccoli?
Broccoli is good stuff. I mean, don't tell President Bush's dad that. He refused to eat it. But broccoli is one of the best things you can do. You know, there's always the story and the fear about making the baby get wind. As long as the winds are passed, it's fine. If you've got a baby who has great difficulty passing winds, then it might be a problem. But certainly those green leafy vegetables and broccoli is great.
Mm, and maybe if they get used to it at a very young age, they won't be like George Bush.
Maybe.
Get used to it. Dolly in Johannesburg. Hi, Dolly.
Hello. I have a problem with my seven-week-year-old son. His tongue.
Yes.
I'm breastfeeding, but his tongue is white, and I've tried everything to try and clean it.
Okay.
And now it's in Mr. Sit oral suspension, but it still doesn't really work for him.
Yes. Okay, Dolly, it sounds to me as though your baby has got something that is so common, and many, many babies get it. It's called thrush. Did anyone mention thrush to you?
Not really.
Okay. Sorry, what medication did you say you got from the chemist?
Nystacid oral suspension.
Okay.
You know, the drops, the yellowish drops.
Yes, that may be fine, but what you really need is to go to the chemist again and say, my baby has got thrush and I need something for it. Either the clinic, I don't know if clinics in your area are giving out that kind of medication, but thrush is very, very common. It's a fungus that we all have, especially women, that lives inside our bodies, and we sometimes get vaginal thrush where you have this white itchy discharge. Now, it's not life-threatening, it's itchy, it's uncomfortable. It can make the baby reluctant to feed, because if the baby really gets a bad overgrowth of thrush into the whole system, you also sometimes get a very bad nappy rash. So it is something you need to deal with. You mustn't worry that it's a huge disease or something really bad. So you've got to get some drops. And if you're breastfeeding, are you breastfeeding, darling?
Yes, I am.
Okay, that's great. Now, one of the things that happens is that the mother infects the baby, and then the breast, you can't see it, but it goes backwards and forwards between the mother and the baby. So you must get something for your breasts as well. Please tell whoever you speak to, your doctor or your pharmacist, that you're breastfeeding, and can you please get something to apply to your breasts as well. It will pass, but it won't pass by itself.
Dolly, before you go, thrush, you say how common it is.
What
is
it? How candida.
How does it present, though? Dolly's saying that the baby's tongue is white. Is it overall white or little spots?
It's white that looks sometimes like milk, because obviously babies' tongues get white from the milk they drink. But if you try to scrape it off, it doesn't come off.
Is that how it is, Dolly?
Yes, that's how it is.
And this, if you have vaginal thrush as an adult, then you would have a white, cheesy, slightly creamy discharge, and it's very, very itchy. And on the breasts, you would often get the mother saying, oh, it's quite sore, and you might get cracked nipples.
Is it going
you don't see white on the breasts.
Going to affect the child in any way other than that they're not going to want to feed very much?
it's a debilitating. Mm. It makes a child reluctant to feed, and when a child doesn't want to feed, it's not good.
So it's
a very
common,
young baby,
but easily sorted. But
very, very common, and quite easily sorted out with the right medication. But it's very hard to kill those spores. Unfortunately, any fungal spore is very, very hard to get rid of. If you're using dummies at all, it's better to boil the dummies and not put them in a sterilizing solution, because somehow the sterilizing solution doesn't always sort it out. So just boil those dummies.
Does that help
you,
darling?
So the medication is something that I have to give to the baby, or is it something that I have to take myself?
No, you must put something on your breast, Dolly.
Okay,
because your baby is sucking and your baby is putting those germs, if we can call it that, on your breast and then sucking and so on. So it's going backwards and forwards. So you've got to give the medication into your baby's mouth, and you've got to get something for your breasts.
But the chemist important. Should be able to help with exactly
what
it
they'll be so
be.
Used to that, it's very common. Okay.
Okay. All right. Good luck. It's always so worrying when they're so very young, isn't it?
When they're very small, you really
have to be concerned. Peter from Johannesburg. Hi there.
Hi. Hello, Peter.
Hi. I have a son. My son is 5.5 years old.
Right.
He seems to sleep very deeply. The way this manifests itself is that he doesn't wake up to wee in the night.
Yes.
So he wets his bed.
Yes.
If we limit how much he drinks from, say, 5:30 in the afternoon, then he sleeps through and he's fine. He doesn't wee through the night.
Yeah.
I've put alarm clocks next to his bed to try and wake up the whole family, but
Shame.
Not him.
Well, I'm happy to tell you, Peter, that, again, this is not uncommon, and it is true that some children sleep so deeply, lucky souls that they are, that they don't wake.
Yeah.
Now, rather than an alarm clock which will wake the whole family, there is something you can get which is an alarm that actually works like a bit like those cell phones. It kind of nudges you. I don't know if it's going to nudge him hard enough.
Yeah, because... You know, we even try and wake him up ourselves, and he's sort of
he's groggy.
Not awake, he's groggy. And he just
but, you know, it's still worth taking him. Does he perform if you take him to the bathroom?
Yes.
It's not a bad thought. Rather than limiting the fluids, which is, it's quite tough.
We make sure that he drinks enough before that.
Yeah. Look, if everybody's okay with the fluids, but one really doesn't, he's going to get past this. It's certainly a very common thing, and 5.5 years, it's not even recommended you see a doctor at that age. However, you do want to deal with it.
It's more discomforting for him than for anybody else.
Yes, I'm sure.
You know,
I'm sure.
His peers might. Okay. His peers don't wear nappies at night.
No, I understand, and one does want to deal with it so that there isn't any residual trauma that you have to deal with.
Would it be the case if the alarm clock went next to their bed and they took it in turns to take him,
I think
that eventually he would get into a pattern?
No, it won't make him sleep lighter. But what you need to do is to perhaps take him before you go to bed, if it's 11 o'clock or night, whatever, and if he's not performing, open the tap and the sound of the running water usually...
There's never been a problem with it when we take him to the toilet that he
can't
see.
So do that.
Yeah.
Do that at least.
Yeah.
And then if you find it's not getting sufficiently better for him to be out of nappies, because I think that's the step you want to be taking quite soon, get one of those alarms. Go to a medical supplies store and say you want the enuresis buzzer.
Enuresis.
Well, that's what they fancy name for bedwetting. Just say the bedwetting buzzer and explore them. There are a few options, and you know your child and you know what is more likely to work with him.
Yeah.
And it doesn't work quickly. It might even take 3 months, but it does work in the end.
Yeah.
So try it.
Okay,
Peter. Good
Thank
luck.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Bye.
Well, today on SAFM, we have Marina Petropulos in the studio with us, and incidentally Marina Petropulos' book Baby and Child Care Handbook has been requested by the Simply South Africa shop in London, which is quite a coup. So along with Mrs. Ball's chutney and anchovy paste, there she will be, very proudly South African. That's really quite something, Marina. Congratulations on that one.
Thank you.
Siganthri on the line from Cape Town. Hi there.
Yes, hi. I've got an 8-month-old son. He
He's presently on a soya-based formula. He has 3 meals a day, and the reason I'm giving you a call is he gets up every hour at night for a feed.
Oh, my.
So it's very difficult.
How much is he having in a total in milk in 24 hours?
It's about 800 mils to 1,000
mils. Oh, that's a lot. Yes. So it's really habit-waking, I think. He's not hungry. He's just got into a habit of needing a drink to get him back to sleep. This is a difficult problem. You must make sure, you did say he's on 3 meals a day.
Yes.
Make sure those are very adequate, sustaining meals. And you're really going to have to cut down a lot on those night feeds, because it seems to me this is just a habit and it's not a good thing for him to have all this milk. He must have his meals during the day, and at 8 months he really doesn't need, especially because he's bottle fed, he doesn't need much. So you must put very little in the bottle at night. You know, you've got to judge so long as he isn't ill or teething or anything like that, and it is difficult to know. But if you feel he's just waking because of habit, you may have to really just give him a tiny little feed and then leave him and let him learn to settle himself. Because what happens is babies get used to somebody else helping them to go back to sleep, and they never learn to settle. So you mustn't reinforce it. That's really the message that I'm giving you. Just cut down as much as you can on what you do to get him to go back to sleep and let him learn to go back himself.
Yes, sorry, two things. How much should he be drinking at this age? He just turned 8 months yesterday,
yes,
actually.
He doesn't need more than 500 mils in 24 hours. The solids are more important at this stage.
Okay.
Sorry, 500 mils of liquid?
Milk. Okay. Milk in 24 hours. Liquid's different, yeah.
Okay, sorry, and the second question is, when he does get up at night, is it okay to perhaps give him water? Will it slowly break his pattern?
You can try that, certainly. If he's not hungry, then water would be fine. Whatever you do, don't give him fruit juice or something like that. It's just going to rot his teeth and reinforce something sweet. So, yes, you can certainly try water. Okay. But if you find that it then means he's waking every hour, because that sometimes happens, then clearly he needed some kind of feeding, and you must look at what he's having during the day and try and increase that. Not in the form of milk, but in the form of solids.
Okay, and sorry, one last thing. You mentioned teething. He is presently teething. He's getting his fifth teeth, tooth at the moment.
Okay.
Now, would that have anything to do with the sleep pattern?
It might, but I think that you will have learned from the other periods of teething just how much distress it gives him. And even so, he should still be able to go back to sleep, you know, unless he's really in pain, and then a bottle feed is not the answer.
So
it's only really if he's in some sort of pain or distress that you must differentiate between needing just comforting from you or comfort in the form of a bottle.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Good luck.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye.
Debbie from Johannesburg. Hi there.
Hi.
Yes, tell us your problem.
Okay, hi Marina.
Hello, Debbie.
I love your book. It's absolutely wonderful. I've had it by my bedside since my daughter, who's now 3, has been born. My question to you is about sibling rivalry.
Next session. We're going to have our whole session on sibling rivalry. It is such a hot subject.
Because I'm starting to feel like a bit of a fishwife, I thought I needed to ask you, how do I do it in a calm way that gets both of them to be well-adjusted children?
Yes, it is difficult, and perhaps we can deal with it briefly here. What's the problem? How are they showing it?
They basically, every toy that my 1-year-old plays with, my 3-year-old takes out of his hands. Now, I feel like all I'm doing is shouting at her, and I really don't want to. You know, she's such a wonderful little girl, and I don't want to break her spirit, and I don't want him to feel like all I'm doing is shouting, and he picks up on this aggression.
Yes.
They're actually both wonderful children, but I do find that they are starting to argue about every toy that's available in the house.
Yeah, that's very typical and understandable, and it's the way she's showing that, you know, he shouldn't really be having anything. You're really going to have to look at some strategies. When he's playing with something, you have to say to her, whatever her name is,
yes,
June, Chloe. Okay, lovely name. Chloe, this belongs to your brother for this period, and he is going to be allowed to play with it.
Yes.
And take her away, and even if she kicks and screams, I want that toy, whatever it is, you really just have to take her away and say, it's not fair to take his toys away.
Yes.
And if you keep on doing that, then I'm going to have to take toys away from you and put them in the cupboard. And if you keep taking his toy, you're going to have to put one of your toys away in the cupboard.
Okay.
It's really all strategies along that line. And try and stay rational. It's very hard, but you're just going to have to deal with it that way.
Okay,
and make sure that she doesn't get even this negative attention, because she doesn't care. Even if you're shouting at her, she's getting some kind of attention.
Well,
and he's losing.
Isn't she old enough to do the, come on, you're a big girl story?
Or? You know what I do is I say, listen, it's his turn now, and he's going to have a turn. And then after he's finished playing with it, which, because he's only 1 year old, is generally 30 seconds and he's lost interest, and then she gets it back. But I don't seem to feel like that is actually working, because she still picks up a fuss.
Yeah, no, I don't think so. I think she's got to know that she can't do that, and life doesn't work like that. You can't actually be bigger and go and grab somebody's things.
Yes.
Really,
yes.
You just have to say to her, it's not fair and I'm not going to have you do it.
Okay, and then he does vice versa as well. When she's playing with a puzzle or something that is
he's not allowed to do
him.
It. He's not allowed to do it. You must just say, look, and physically pick him up and take him away and just say, you know, distraction at one is very easy. At three, it's also quite easy, but not as easy. So, but you can be more rational with her. With him, you just have to distract him and say,
okay, great.
Good luck,
thanks
Debbie.
Thanks so much for your help.
And
you,
try and listen on the first Friday of next month, because sibling rivalry will be on the menu.
Great, thanks a lot.
It's the sort of thing that makes you realise why people go out to work. Shame. But there's light at the end of the tunnel. Louise from Cape Town, hi there.
Hello, Marina.
Hi, Louise.
We have a problem with my three-year-old grandson. You know, whenever he comes here to visit, he doesn't want to greet us.
Oh, yes.
And, you know, my husband gets a bit upset, and I think he upsets everybody. He won't say goodbye to Nana, he won't say hello to Nana, he won't say hello Granny or hello Opa. And I'm wondering what we must do about it. My daughter insists that she must smack him. Because she says he's being rude.
Yes.
So now what do we do in this case?
It comes out as rudeness, but there is something else behind that. And I'm not entirely sure what it is. I think he just feels as though he's possibly being bossed about too much.
Mm.
And this is his way of showing that he can have a mind of his own and he can choose who he can say hello and goodbye to. I think he should become invisible to you when he comes.
You think we must just ignore it?
You must ignore him.
No, ignore him.
I think he'll hate that.
Same, I can't do that.
No, ignore him. And then suddenly you might suddenly see him and or ask his mother where he is and say, oh, were you here the whole time? Oh, sorry, I didn't hear you say hello.
Yeah, a little bit of play acting.
And then next time, see if he says hello on his own. But whatever his mother does, she mustn't smack him for it, because it really is not working, and it never will.
It would be an awful thing if he associated going to see...
No, it's just his little power play.
This is what worries me, that he won't want to come here because he has to say hello.
Yes, you see, it's just a power play, because hello is really not the issue at all. Hello is really harmless, but no smacking. It's really not a
thanks
smackable
so
offence.
Thank you very, very much.
Thanks very much.
Thanks very much.
Good luck.
Ladies. Bye.
And thank you, Marina, once again for joining us on Women Today. We look forward to speaking to you again on the first Friday of next month with Sibling Rivalry.
Thank you. I can't believe the time has passed.
So from us all here in the Cape Town studio, till Monday, cheerio.